Hello and welcome to Premier Injuries. And we're talking today about a huge issue at the moment. A quick turnaround has happened at the revolving door at Stamford Bridge. And again, we see another manager departing from the Blues with Lampard going and Thomas Tuchel coming in. But today I have the pleasure of welcoming onto Premier Pundits my friend, I will call you a good friend here, Dan. Dan from the London is Blue podcast. Now, before we get into it all, we do know that football is just a game. So I do have to ask, how are you doing personally at the moment, Dan? Are you coping with this weird situation we're living in?
Yeah, you know, I definitely, unlike Frank Lampard, did not suffer from results-itis and find myself lacking in employment. So things are good for me on that end, but we are all healthy and safe. And, you know, as we had a chance to chat before we actually started recording, it seems like both of us are in a similar position there as well. So yeah, in general, things are good, and Chelsea is chaotic. So of course, you know, things are just par for the course, given all the lack of normalcy. This is a normal thing to be talking about, a manager being replaced.
Ironically, yeah. I mean, Chelsea are doing Chelsea things. I don't want to insult the club, but this is kind of at least a bit of normalcy. We're seeing Chelsea getting rid of a boss at some point in the season and chaos ensuing around the club. But we do have to start with Lamps. And, you know, I personally, even though I'm an Arsenal fan, I had a huge soft spot for him and I wished him well. And I know for you yourself, this is going to be a hard one to deal with, but I do have to ask, and the rumours are circulating, the discussions in the press are, that a lot of this was to do with off the pitch as well as on pitch poor results. So can you talk us through, because it seems like from the summer of 2020, weirdly, where he got the club into a relatively good place, maybe exceeded expectations, but there was even rumours then that Lampard's time was soon to be over and the pressure was on him then. Was he basically doomed after the end of last season?
I wouldn't say that Lampard was doomed. I think that the expectations were always going to increase year over year, particularly with a return of being able to sign players, getting into the top four and being involved in Champions League football, having not won a trophy the prior season and getting into an FA Cup final where there would have been an opportunity to get silverware. You know, there were definitely things that, you know, Lampard could have done both from a football and performance and a, you know, an off the pitch type of performance to put the club in a better position and potentially have found his way through what was a really troubling run over the last 2 to 2.5 months where the results just didn't match where the club is looking to go, you know, in this season, every season, which is to go out and win a title or compete for trophies. And, you know, I think what we saw is just a lack of footballing identity. We saw, you know, I think a divide even within our own fan base where there were people who were disappointed with where the results are and, you know, maybe kind of pointing it at the finger of, you know, players aren't performing at the moment. You know, that obviously there's the situation with COVID and things just not being normal. And so I think there were some who said, you know, it's Lampard, he's one of our best players ever. We should give him the opportunity to be successful and find a way forward. And, you know, every other manager had slumps. You know, Ole had a slump at United. They kind of worked their way up to the top of the table. Arteta had a slump at the beginning of the season. They found themselves level on points with Chelsea at the moment. And so every team has seemingly had this ebb and flow of the season. And this was just the fever that didn't break for Frank. You know, this was one where, you know, it didn't eventually subside down and normalcy return. It was as if the results just couldn't stabilize and find ourselves back on that solid footing. And so I wouldn't say that he was doomed from the summer. I think that the expectations just naturally increase. And Frank, more than anyone, knows what that means at Chelsea. And so I would say that it definitely was more of a footballing decision than an off the pitch decision.
Do you feel, though, that on the pitch, the club let Lampard down? Because there was this big talk of him seemingly being frozen out of big discussions at the club. And then the huge one was the refusal to re-sign Declan Rice or a midfielder that Lampard really wanted. But as you said there, should Lampard know better than anybody else that this is not the way that Chelsea function?
I think it's a fair criticism of our board for the way that they've operated, not just in the past 12 months. And I think there has been a natural excitement from our supporters getting to go out and sign Timo Werner and Kai Havertz and Ben Chilwell and to bring the star-studded talents to Stamford Bridge in a fashion that we haven't seen since some of the very early era moments of Roman Abramovich's reign as Chelsea owner. And so I think there was a little bit of air being let out of the balloon when they didn't all come good right away or they were taking time to acclimatize. But when you look at our results and you look at the way that the midfield so often was sliced through, even with N'Golo Kanté on the pitch, and it was very clear that an area that Chelsea needed some stability would have been in defensive midfielder. I don't think it necessarily had to be Declan Rice, even though he's continuing to show, you know, year over year performance improvement in what he can offer. I do think that if there was an area of the pitch where, you know, beyond goalkeeper, which is where, you know, that obviously getting a replacement for Kepa was one of the biggest year over year kind of improvements there, just within, you know, total, you know, expected goals conceded improvement to offer, defensive midfielder would have been an important part of that. And not getting that, I do think challenged Frank a little bit, but there also maybe were, you know, in more inventive solutions. You know, we've seen Billy Gilmore have an opportunity much later in the season here to come in and try his chance. You know, we've seen Mason Mount deployed a little deeper for the England squad, and he's been able to execute there in a little bit more of a defensive kind of positioning opportunity. And so whether or not Frank was experimental enough with the players that he did have to try and do something different, maybe is the question, or maybe go to things like trying the back three, which we ultimately did versus Wolves, which I think we all thought if Frank stayed, we might try back three at Wolves since it worked previously. But I do think that not necessarily Declan specific, but a lack of defensive midfielder was a letdown. That should have been a prioritized signing, and we just didn't see it come through.
But as you said there, and explained quite well, this is something that Michael Cox of The Athletic attests to, that the Chelsea midfield were really easy to pass through. And he said, without the ball, it has been an organisational issue and cost them in the big matches. So does that all come down to Lampard? Was that a lack of tactical nous to kind of see this is a problem? And maybe not because the personnel weren't arguably there, that he should have had another workaround, do you feel?
I think it's a tough argument to make when in the last season, he was also able to beat Mourinho twice in a league campaign. And so I do think at times it came down to player selection. You know, I think that we have seen that there are, you know, players in this side like Jorginho, who, you know, maybe kind of is a luxury midfielder in the Premier League who doesn't maybe move the ball as fast enough, gets closed down a little too quickly, reverts backwards in kind of a passing patterns that doesn't maybe necessarily aid in a, you know, if you want to play this high possession, high pressing side, Jorginho is not the first name that would ever be on a team sheet or maybe on the substitute bench. So I do think there were times where we were a little too, we tried to be too cute in getting away with things. You know, we put all this emphasis on trying to play, you know, really hard against Fulham, and then we go and you know, get torn apart by Leicester. And you know, I think it was the situation of, you know, we only beat Fulham 1-0, and that was Mason Mount coming through with a pretty spectacular goal to make it happen. And so I do think there might have been, you know, some lack of, you know, just experience and understanding, but you know, it's only his second year as a, it was only his second year as a, you know, Premier League coach, third year in management total. And his only experience was, you know, with Derby, where, you know, he got them into a playoff position, ultimately did not kind of get them across the line there. And, you know, was able to take us to, you know, kept us in fourth place in the Champions League spot last season. And, you know, was maybe struggling with the challenges this season. But he's not alone. Like it's tough when you look at the fact that, you know, you're talking about a 10 point spread at times between first place, like 10th or 11th place this season. And so it's just an odd one. And I think that's where maybe the supporters were a little challenged at times, is that because it looks hard when you say, oh, you're in 10th place, but that 10th place is 3 points or 5 points, it doesn't necessarily feel as gargantuan as a challenge to maybe overcome. And so that's maybe where we kind of have some questions around, like, well, you know, other managers got the opportunity to work through it, but the results obviously had not kind of improved over maybe a longer period relative to some of the other slumps that United worked through, Arsenal worked through this season.
What is interesting for me from a data perspective as well is that there was a slump exactly like this time last season from game week 20 onwards in the Premier League, 6 points out for possible 15, no clean sheet for a long time. And the data has been up and down through Lampard's time. Sometimes the side was producing top three data or better, whereas there were other times like recently where the numbers are bottom half of the table stuff. What do you think the reason is for this ebb and flow from being so good to so poor in such a space of time?
It's a tough one, and you know, maybe your boss Ben would have better perspective on it, but there were times where Chelsea would look worse with more time to prepare for a match than when we had less time to prepare. When we would have a 5 or 6 or 7 day window, how tired, how slow the players were heading into those matches relative to a match where maybe they just didn't have the time to go get trained once or twice in the day to train extremely hard. I mean, we've heard Frank talk about, you know, what he looks for in his players, and you know, they do follow, or did follow under him, a very aggressive training regimen. And it just seemed odd that we never found the right balance of training the tactics versus training for fitness. And it seems like maybe similar to the Pochettino sides that for Spurs, that, you know, would fly at the start and then have this type of, you know, experience where it'd be like, oh, maybe they were overtrained, maybe they have been pressing too much, maybe they've been running too hard. You know, I think we found ourselves sometimes pressing without intent. And so to press for press sake is going to really run your side a little ragged. You know, even with players who, you know, are not injury prone, knock on wood, like Mason Mount, playing almost every minute of the Premier League season so far. And then you have N'Golo Kante, who, you know, is, you know, more of an injury concerned player now as he progresses in his, you know, playing age. Second highest minutes for Chelsea this season. And so if you're going to continue to rely upon some of the same players, you know, it's going to put you in a position where maybe they're not going to be able, you know, if they typically would give you an eight out of 10 performance, maybe that's going to subside to a 6 or a 5 if you're relying on them every single match, particularly when there's 2 to 3 in a very short window. And so I do think that's maybe where some of the understanding of how to manage through a difficult time, how to manage through the fixture calendar is showing where there is a little bit of opportunity to Frank to understand where he could have understood how to manage that a little bit better.
Would you say, though, that it might be a management issue, but was he also a bit unlucky with injuries? You know, some of the things, Chilwell, Reece James, and as you mentioned there, Kante as well. It just seemed that these sort of injuries came at the wrong time for him.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think any injury cover comes at the right time. I don't think you hope that any of your players, you know, I think we know that Christian Pulisic is going to probably always have some type of concern around his hamstring. You know, it's just a injury that can be aggravated over time, and you have to be very thoughtful about, you know, when you give him rotation, how many minutes you play him, much like a pitcher in baseball. You know, there's probably a minute count for Christian, much like there would be a pitch count for a baseball player. And, you know, N'Golo Kante is older. He did have issues, you know, post the Mauricio Sarri season, after, you know, the Europa League final, and, you know, missed almost half of last season. And so when we think about just the management of the squad, you know, we do have a substantially large squad. I do think that there are some that don't have a like for like replacement. There's not a like replacement for N'Golo Kanté on the side, Ben Chilwell downgrading to Emerson or Alonso, that's a downgrade too. Reece and Aspi offer different things, but rotation maybe could have happened there. I think there's were options to try and manage it. But I don't necessarily know if we ever found that perfect 11, because very rarely were these six new signings available to be chosen at the same time in Frank's tenure. So I think that that's also maybe a bit of a challenge too, is that, you're right. He was unlucky. Some of that might have been caused from overtraining or overplaying, though. And so, not all of it was freak injury, freak accident. I think some of it is just, has to go down to, if you're going to continue to train aggressively hard, if you're going to have situations where you're not allowing the appropriate amount of rest or recovery time, then you're going to be the captain of your own downfall.
Now, you've mentioned there that obviously some players did have like-for-like changes, others did not. But from the outside, it looked like almost an impossible situation with managing a squad packed with such talent. I mean, looking at somebody like myself at Arsenal, I would like to be with Chelsea's problem of Pulisic and Werner playing in similar areas, Havertz and Ziyech. So looking at this kind of historical data of heat touch maps and player positions, as mentioned there, there's quite a few players that play in similar areas. Was it really hard for Lampard, maybe unfairly hard, to pick the right 11 each week when so many of those players deserve to be in any Premier League team?
Yeah, it's an impossible ask. And I think the other end of that is not necessarily the 11 that get picked, but it's those who go unused. It's those who don't get an opportunity to play and are looking for, not only their personal career, but also what maybe their contribution is going to be to their national teams. Obviously, the Euros is still coming up this summer. And so you have players like Olivier Giroud, who wants to make sure that he can, continue forward and progress as, one of the leading goal scorers in France's history. And you have Billy Gilmore, who wants to make it into the Scotland side and get that opportunity. And so you have players in this team that are looking for not only necessarily how well Chelsea do, but how well their kind of own personal or professional career is going. And so I think this is one area where the board could have been more ruthless in how we moved on from players this summer to make it a little easier for Lampard to manage. We ended up keeping Fikayo Tomori, who ends up going on loan now to AC Milan, has a really nice first substitute appearance there. But he's someone who started a significant number of matches at the beginning part of last season, found himself out of favor, and then really struggled to get a loan both the start of this season and even this winter. And so, but now we have Antonio Rudiger has seemingly popped back up the table even before Tuchel came in and is now starting next to Silva when Kurt Zouma has been one of the better defenders and has scored more goals for Chelsea than some of the top goal scorers for other teams. So it clearly presented a challenge, and you were obviously always going to not make everybody happy. But it would have been nice to see maybe just one or two of the players that have been maybe maligned or struggled for minutes moved on, so they could really make it easier for Frank to manage. When you have too many people and not enough work, obviously somebody's going to become unhappy.
So just to summarize with the Lampardges, and I know this one will be mixed with a bit of nostalgia, obviously, for his playing days, but how fondly will you remember this Lampard tenure? Is this something of a positive time for the Blues, or is this maybe a hard one to deal with?
I think it will always be a positive era because of who Frank was able to help bring through from the academy into the first team. Mason Mount is a Premier League starter. Reece James is a Premier League starter. We have at least set the foundation for hopefully Callum Hudson-Odoi under Tuchel now to be a regular Premier League starter. Tammy Abraham is one of the best goal scorers in the, you know, strikers in the Premier League at the moment. And so I think beyond anything else, the sometimes frustrating results, sometimes great results, you know, it's unfortunate when we look back and we, you know, we did a retrospective on our show and we're trying to think about, you know, what were some of our favorite moments. Typically, when we think about favorite moments as Chelsea supporters, you're thinking about this title or this trophy, that night in Munich. And you have those kind of thoughts about it. With Lampard, it was like, oh, well, doing the double over Spurs. And like, we don't as a club usually celebrate like individual match moments. It's kind of, it feels a little club at times. And so I'm probably not going to try to think about those things as much, but I will think about the fact that he set a really great foundation for a substantial number of players who are homegrown from our academy to become first team players, whether through the bench or through being a starting player for Chelsea. And as long as that, the club are good stewards of that moving forward. You know, obviously we kept Joe Edwards as one of the coaches will be part of Tuchel's staff. And, you know, obviously Petr Cech is, you know, in our kind of player personnel, you know, advisory role there. And so as long as we keep that intact, the, you know, the Conor Gallagher's, the Mark Gerhys, you know, the other individuals that are the next ones up, and keep that path going, then Frank will have done something wonderfully magical for this club. And may, you know, depending upon what the success looks like for Chelsea in the future, may actually surpass what he did for us as a player. And so that, but time will have to tell on that one.
The thing was, when Lampard joined, I felt a lot of these things were there, that it was building for the future. But we do have to move on to the future, which is now, which is Tuchel. And starting off, hopefully positively, are you happy with this managerial acquisition?
Yeah, I think it's hard not to be excited about a manager who has won trophies before. I think that is an expectation at Chelsea. You know, he has said it himself in his initial press conference, his interview with the Chelsea kind of TV, or kind of the internal content team as well. But he understands the expectations. It's also a short contract. So it's a prove it contract, right? It's 18 months. I think there might be some option to extend for a year, depending upon how well both sides think that it's going. But I don't think, it seems like he's not under any illusion that this is a place where you go to set up and stay for a decade. And this maybe gets back to a little bit more of the ruthless Roman who, beyond all else, prioritizes winning, prioritizes trophies. And, you know, he has done that. He has managed some really tough personalities at PSG and almost got them to win a Champions League final. And so, look, I mean, I think that's the type of pedigree that Chelsea want when we look for a managerial appointment. It doesn't hurt that, you know, he shares a nationality with two of our most expensive signings ever in Timo Werner and Kai Havertz. And so hopefully that is another thing that he can help find some goodness in, because he's got a lot of work cut out for him here.
See, that's the funny thing. I was going to ask, do you think it's more than just a coincidence that the new manager is from the same country of origin as these two big signings? Was he almost brought in to facilitate both of their growths?
You know, it's not the first time that Chelsea have evaluated Tuchel as an option. You know, he's been evaluated previously, and you know, there was, you know, I think some scouting previously of even you know, Pochettino, who you know, with him signing, I think that there was a thought with the Chelsea, you know, within Chelsea, that if they didn't make the move to go get Tuchel, who was looking to kind of get back into a job maybe before the end of the season, that if they didn't make the move, that they would find themselves with a caretaker manager that they weren't necessarily happy with, or potentially would not achieve their targets that they were looking for this season. And so, you know, this just seemed to be kind of a more of a perfect alignment of opportunity where Tuchel was available. They needed to make a change. Maybe there would have been their first choice, and, you know, Pochettino was not available anymore. They did kind of try to go after Ragnick, you know, previously coached at Leipzig for like a you know, bridge opportunity as well. And, you know, so I don't necessarily know if he was, you know, the first choice. You know, maybe they kind of did shuffle through a couple of choices, but it's helpful. It's helpful that, you know, he's going to be able to play with, you know, have players that he is either slid, and he did want to bring Rudiger to PSG. He's, you know, obviously spoken about N'Golo Kanté before, and he's now spoken about how excited he is to have Kanté in his side. And he's going to know, you know, both Havertz and Werner from his time in the Bundesliga. And he now has Christian Pulisic, who he had on his squad as well. And so there's a lot of, you know, kind of good energy, I think, that we see from maybe some players getting to take advantage of a relationship that they have had outside of the club, or have maybe been, you know, in conversation, been scouted by him previously, that he can build upon quickly.
Now, turning it to the style of football here, and a lot of people talk and wax lyrical about Tuchel's ability to create some amazing football on the pitch, but what kind of shift of style should we expect from Chelsea now that Tuchel is at the helm? And adding to this, which players do you think will benefit most from this systematic change?
Yeah, I think it's super early, and it's going to be tough to say which players are going to be the biggest beneficiaries of it. You know, even in this first match, the 0-0 draw versus Wolves, you know, Tuchel came out and said, I chose experience. I was a little concerned with some of the younger guys on the team, and maybe, you know, getting manager getting sacked, bad run of form. If they go out and have a bad result, I don't want there to be a negative consequence for it. So I just went with veterans. You know, I didn't necessarily. Now, he did also play Callum Hudson-Odoi starting, so, you know, maybe kind of betrayed himself a little bit with his team selection there. But ultimately, you know, it seems like, you know, if he's given opportunities to players like Callum, Mason comes in for about a 10-minute cameo at the end and looks extremely bright. No surprise there. Tammy looks, you know, maybe a little bit more fresh than Giroud. Especially kind of running at a defensive line. And so, you know, I think ultimately things that we can look forward to are, you know, I think it will be continue to be possession-based football, you know, maybe similar to what we saw with Mauricio Sarri. I do think what we did see is there were attempts at forward passes, not necessarily over the top, which was interesting because we do have some runners in the squad. You know, if you think you, if you did have Timo Werner in there, you'd be able to maybe chip over and try to kind of get him playing one-on-one. That would be interesting. Same with Pulisic. You know, so I don't necessarily know if we know exactly how it's going to work out. You know, he's used plenty of different formations over his time in different squads. I mean, he does have a couple of preferred favorites. But in general, I think it will be an evolution of what we saw between what Frank was doing, what Conte was doing, what Sarri was doing. And, but you know, I think quick, yeah, I would hope that the one thing that I've seen his sides do is play very quickly with the ball and look to pass, to look to kind of get it into dangerous areas. And one of the things that we have seen, you know, with Frank's side over this season is we were slow in build up at times. You know, we would recycle quite frequently, you know, possession for nothing. You know, there were some great stats about how many passes we had in this game versus Wolves. And it's great when you have tons of passes, but when you don't convert one shot into a goal, then the passing numbers are just, you know, they're superfluous.
It's a bit like bargain bucket Barcelona, isn't it? It's if it doesn't go into the back of the net, then what is the point? But yeah, moving on to a criticism of Lampard, which was sometimes a lack of clear tactical instructions or even a clear philosophy. This is, you know, things coming out of the club, but also from commentators from the outside of the club looking in. But then my point is that he kind of puts previous Chelsea boss Tinkerman Ranieri's changes to shame. You know, he's chopping and changing. Tuchel likes this, and he likes to keep opponents guessing as well. But In terms of Fantasy Premier League, because we do have to mention that because a lot of our viewers do that, that's going to make it hard to choose fantasy assets. But also there is the question of, could Tuchel be over-tinkering too much, over-managing? And this is something that people have said about Pep Guardiola when he gets to the Champions League in Europe, that there's almost a panic to over-manage and overthink the opponent. And in my personal opinion, I don't like this management style, but he does try to capitalize on opponents' weaknesses. And he's not scared to give the whole team an overhaul of formation, tactics, and even personnel between games. He is quite the pragmatist. So is this what Chelsea needs, or would you like a more clear, defined style that you can just read out the playbook and the players can kind of almost rest upon?
Yeah, I don't think the copy-paste lineup that Lampard was using, it definitely got to a point where it was copy-paste in his first season, and maybe even the first half of the season, you could tell, regardless of injuries, you had a pretty good idea of if this person is healthy, they're going to start. I do think there is a possibility, particularly over the next 3 to 4 weeks, that there might be high variability in the squad. And so as someone who also plays Fantasy Premier League, I only have one Chelsea player in my squad at the moment. Ben Chilwell has been my consistent, but I do wish that he would return to his form of assisting or scoring goals. He had a wonderful chance versus Wolves and just maybe kind of, angled it up a little too high. But if he started getting into those positions again more regularly, I think there could be some positive return there. Obviously, Zuma was a great asset to own, but then getting dropped was a little bit of a challenge. Reese was a great, any of our defensive options in the beginning of the season were fantastic. And then the results started to wane a little bit. Obviously, Tammy has been maybe a really good return as a lower value or lower cost striking solution. For players who are trying to kind of maximize maybe their midfield spend on some of the premium mids and trying to figure out how they can pay a little less for their striking options up top. And so, I probably would look towards, if Callum starts to get opportunities where he is starting with a regular basis, that would be a very interesting option for me in terms of both cost and output. He's, second or third, depending upon which stat table you're looking at, for expected goals plus assists per 90 in our team, and only Giroud, who tends to play a little less, in terms of total minutes, and Tammy Abraham are ahead of him in the side. And so that's something that if he is going to get an expanded role, you would assume that the data would tell you that he will be a high value contributor and is going to be lower cost than maybe some of the other options out there.
Yeah, I think this is going to be an exciting time for looking at Callum Hudson-Odoi. And also Chilwell is a great shout. I think people can see the historical nature of Tuchel's sides, that they go and attack, and Chilwell will be an integral part to that. But it seems like you're actually quite excited almost by... it almost reflects the Chelsea way that the club is run, just anarchy on the pitch. It's going to be hard to pin down. And what I would say as well, he often uses the 4-3-3 formation, but has deployed the 4-treble-2. He's used the 3-5-2 and the 4-1-4-1. But, that does give tactical diversity. But which do you think he will deploy at Chelsea? And do you think there's some nailed on players? Obviously Mendy, I think Chilwell will be fine, and maybe you're saying Callum Hudson-Odoi, but is the rest all up in the air each game week?
Yeah, I do think it's going to be interesting. I think the Burnley lineup here will be a little bit more telling, because he'll have had opportunities to evaluate the squad, get a few more training sessions in beforehand to understand who he's got. I think Thiago Silva, no surprise, is probably going to be a constant performer throughout the remainder of the season. I think Mendy and Chilwell are obviously, as long as they stay healthy, or great shouts or locks there. I think N'Golo Kanté, when healthy and available, is an absolute lock. I wouldn't be surprised if Mason ends up being kind of a continued starter. Maybe get some rotation, which actually would not be a bad thing for him, considering how much he's getting played. And then I think it really is going to come down to, who gets firing first. I think if someone like Ziyech, starts, assisting at a high value, high kind of return, maybe he ends up locking down that right-hand side. I think between Christian and Callum, Christian's numbers are a far cry from where they were in that restart period this season. And, probably could lose out to Callum if Callum shifts over maybe to the left-hand side, if we are playing that 4-3-3 and you're thinking Maybe Tammy up top with Callum on one side and Ziyech on the other has looked good in periods in this season. Mount and Havertz plus Conte in the midfield makes a lot of sense, especially if Havertz continues to kind of find his form. Obviously, you know, he was probably one of the most prominent individuals in the Premier League to get COVID and to really suffer negatively from that in terms of building back up to a match fitness level. And so I think there are a couple of ones that will find their way in, but it does feel more like a City situation where if the squad is healthy, you don't necessarily know what you're going to get out of a Tuchel in the lineup. So it feels like another Pep and City type of experience. So just trying to find the one or two that start regularly and maybe not have a maximum of three Chelsea players in your side. You might go gray early.
I mean, we always talk about the bald fraud with Pep Guardiola and his roulette wheel. I mean, we can say that Tuchel's, I'd say, semi-bald, would you say? It's an interesting one. We're talking about hairstyles when we're coming to this. But, I mean, one of the things as well is it's going to be crazy hard to do. But if he sticks with the 4-3-3, he's got to cement a front three. My question to you, though, is do you think he'll be able to get the best out of Timo Werner? This has been the big, big thing this season. Do you think that maybe that the fact that Tuchel has worked in the Bundesliga, there is that German connection, there is that similarity a little bit in tactics as well, will that kind of almost give Werner his confidence back? Because I think that's the big thing. A player like Werner doesn't turn bad overnight. It is definitely something to do with confidence, psychology, and he's just not finishing like he used to. So will Werner turn it around?
Gosh, I hope so. It's an unfortunate thing to watch someone struggle so much who clearly is trying his hardest. And I think that's maybe where, you know, no fan has lost their support for Timo Werner in the Chelsea camp. I think, you know, you saw his frustration not scoring the penalty in the last match where he had a chance to, you know, break his duck a little bit there and find some luck, and just took the form of it completely differently. You know, he's always kind of had a power kind of quick run up and just, you know, late, you know, puts the laces through it and tries to, you know, create a hole in the back of the net. And that's not what happened. It was really a softer presentation and maybe just a, gosh, I really don't want to screw this up type of moment. He's eighth overall in non-expected penalty goals this season, or non-penalty expected goals this season in the league, right behind Jamie Vardy and ahead of Heung-Min Son. He's ninth overall per 90. Like, so clearly he's been getting in a good position. He's just not converting his chances. And, you know, he, to his, you know, maybe his defense, he was a streaky player in the Bundesliga. You know, there were periods of 4 to 5 games where he wouldn't score. And then he'd pop up and have 2 or 3 matches in a row where he scored and he'd be back to not scoring again. And so, you know, I think that that's something that maybe as supporters, Chelsea supporters or Premier League owners weren't necessarily aware of, just, you know, his streakiness in scoring. And so that is something that, you know, maybe would be considered. But if he does get returning to form, watch out. You know, that would be something that would be very exciting. And, you know, clearly he can get in the right positions. He can use his speed to really frustrate defenders. And there are plenty of teams that are there to be taken if you have a fast front three. And so I think his big challenge will be is if we are playing a front three, you look at, you have Callum Hudson-Odoi, who from a stats level is actually, you know, generally from like at least his assist standpoint on his limited minutes has done very well. You have Tammy Abraham, who is the team's, you know, best scorer at the moment and, you know, continuing to find the back of the net when he makes it on. And then you're talking about, well, do you play Callum on the right, which is not his best position. He definitely is much better on the left. If you have Ziyech available, Where's the spot for Timo Werner? And so that will be the challenge. And I think that is what we'll be interested to see is how does Tuchel navigate this situation where he has an abundance of options and limited spots.
I think one of the big things as well for Werner, hopefully under Tuchel, will be he won't be as involved in build-up play, because I think that's where maybe Lampard's made a bit of a mistake with him, is he's been involved in passing and moving the ball. And I think that has knocked his confidence as well, because he'll get dispossessed or he'll misplace the pass and he'll be overcritical of himself, whereas he just needs to be making the runs and taking the shots. That's what he's good at. And I like that you call him a streaky player. I call him Baconish, because you know, that's the title that I give. But yeah, I think Tuchel will kind of work that out. So my final question to finish, and hopefully again it's a positive one, I don't want to bring you down at all, Dan, but is Tuchel the right man for the Blues at the moment?
You know, he seems like it. You know, I mean, he's said all the right things. He is talking about unity. He's talking about bringing the players together. You know, he talked about the number of stoppages in the final third that the team was able to execute upon in his post-match press conference. He played Callum Hudson-Odoi, who has struggled to get starts, even while being one of our better players, in limited minutes. First results are you know, kind of look positive. I mean, you could imagine if we had been more clinical on any of the chances, even Kovacic, you know, who doesn't like to score goals, if he had been a little bit closer on his targeting, might have been the one to score the win for us. Rudiger could have gotten a header. Chilwell could have, you know, scored his opportunity. Tammy could have made his run across the box a little bit quicker at the very end minutes of the game there. Drew could have not been offside. Like, we had gotten into good positions against Wolves. And so it just comes down to, can we finish it appropriately? And if he can help bring that back to this side, then yeah, I think he will be, because he talks about winning titles. He talks about the importance of trophies, and he's on an 18-month deal. So he knows that it's not a long-term romance. It's not a long-term fantasy. It's a man who's come in to do a job. And those sometimes tend to be the ones for us here at Chelsea who, you know, we grow fond of. They get an opportunity to impress for a little bit, and maybe he won't be here long term, but that's okay. You know, we've had our romance with Frank Lampard. Romance is dead. We are back to ruthless, cutthroat savagery and taking the league by storm.
But back to the old roots then, really, of Chelsea, the original days. And just, you know, I've given my final question here, but as the Chelsea expert, you know, getting you on here, is there a final message of hope or warning to the FPL community? What kind of advice can you give over the coming months for FPL assets?
Yeah, I think it goes back to trying to figure out who are the permanent starters on the squad. You know, I do think what has been good is, you know, even in some of these bad performances, you know, Chelsea do limit opposition players to high quality shots. We, you know, outside of a couple of, you know, really weird matches, we have not given away many goals. And so a little return to defensive responsibility could find you with a defensive asset that's getting a fair number of clean sheets. You know, obviously, if Chilwell is, you know, advancing a little further forward, can be involved in with the occasional assist and goal, could be a really nice return on investment. And I wouldn't sleep on Callum. You know, I think that's the other one that I would just be, you know, he's going to be, you know, maybe undervalued for an extended period of time. And so, you know, if you're looking to wild card, you know, in some of the blank game weeks coming up in the mid 20, that might be the time, you know, once we've kind of settled a little bit more, once we know who is going to be the regular individuals in the squad, maybe that would be the point to try to bring in multiple individuals from this Chelsea side. But I would probably, Let Tuchel experiment for a little bit before you bring in three Chelsea players immediately. I would not advise that. I don't have it as a Chelsea supporter, so I would not advise it to someone else.
I love that advice. And just for everybody listening, Callum Hudson-Odoi is 0.3% owned, 5.7 value. And Chelsea do have a great run of fixtures to kind of try this out in. Burnley, Tottenham will be a difficult one. Sheffield United, Newcastle and Southampton in the next six. It's not bad at all. This could be a huge turnaround for Chelsea. But as always, a huge thanks to you, Dan. It's a pleasure as always to chat to you. You're a bona fide friend of the show, a friend of myself. And just as always, I urge people to make sure to listen to your brilliant London is Blue podcast. I mean, funnily enough, just as we're ending here, my grand's, I told her who I was having on today, and she actually, you know, when I was chatting to her, she said, oh, they've got something wrong though. And I said, what's that? And she said, well, London is red, because she's a big gooner. So I don't know if you want to have words there with Granny McKenna, but just a huge thanks for your time today, Dan. It's a pleasure as always to chat to you.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. And, you know, I think the biggest thing we can all hope for is just a safe and healthy end to this Premier League season for all these players who, you know, all of us have, you know, kind of had to endure in our own ways, but they're still going out and giving a lot and playing hard and, you know, trying to, you know, keep us entertained and keep us content with being indoors. And so it'll be nice, hopefully, maybe in the back half of this year to get back over to the UK and enjoy a match in London with fans again. And I think that's the thing that we can all hope for at some point in this wild year. But it was great to be back.
Yeah, it's great chatting to you. Maybe when things are normal as well, we can grab a beer together. But yes, we're going to say goodbye and thanks. And do make sure to check out the London is Blue podcast.